Okay, so we continue our work, and I have the pleasure to introduce Juliana Coelho, and she's talking about undiagonality of stable curves.
Is it on? Yeah. Okay, thank you. And let me just start by saying that this is joint with Frederico Sercio. So. And, well, the talk is more or less divided in three parts. So let's start with the, I can never do this. It's like this, whatever. The introduction. And, well, let's start from the beginning, right? So I want to get to stable curves, but let's start with the gonality of a smooth curve. So how do you define gonality of a smooth curve? So we say that a smooth curve is smooth curve C is k-gonal if it admits a map 2p1 of degree k. So, I mean, classically, the gonality is the smallest of these k's. So it's the least of such k's that there is a map from C to P1 of degree k. We're not going to be concerned with this least thing. So we're going to work with this definition. So a curve is k-gonal, a smooth curve is k-gonal, if there is a map of degree k from C to P1. And the question is, OK, what about C? Singular. So, I mean, we cannot simply replace smooth with some singularity here or erase this smoothness condition because it's not, I mean, this is not a good definition. So what we actually want is to understand how, I mean, what type of curves arise as limits of smooth k-gonal curves. So we want to consider families, we want to consider limits. So the actual question is, what curves arise as limits of smooth k-gonal curves. And I mean, we're taking limits in what sense? In the sense of families. And the first thing we notice is that, OK, here I have any curve, but we need only to concern with stable curves, right? Because we know that the limits of smooth curves can be taken to be a stable curve. So what I'm saying is that we have the moduli of smooth curves of genus G. And this can be compactified by considering stable curves of, again, genus G. And what is a stable curve? So this is a nodal curve. And if I have a rational component, then what I need is that this component meets the rest of the curve in at least 3 points. Oh, it's the thing that Alex told us about. You know, you need the automorphism groups of these curves to be finite. So you need, whenever you have a rational component, which could increase the automorphism group, you need to fix it by at least 3 points so you have a finite automorphism groups. OK, so this is the type of curves we're going to work with. And well, so what we want to understand then is stable k-gonal curve. And what do we mean? I mean, like I said, we want limits. So we say that a stable curve is k-gonal if the thing that we want, if it is a limit of smooth k-gonal curves. So this is the object we want you to understand. And what Harris and Manfred showed is that this can be seen through something called admissible curves. So what they showed is that a stable curve C is k-gonal if and only if there exists a k-sheeted admissible curver that I'm going to call pi from C prime to B, where the C prime is not exactly C, but it's something that is stably equivalent to C. So where C prime is stably equivalent to C, meaning that this C prime can be obtained contracting lines in C prime. So let's say, for instance, I have a C prime like this. This is not a stable curve. Why? Because my line here, my P1 here, meets the rest of the curve in 2 points only. But contracting this to a point, we get our C, which is the stable one. So in this picture, this C prime is the one that's stably equivalent to C. And well, what is a k-sheeted admissible curver? So a k-sheeted admissible cover is a finite morphism pi, say from some curve C to some curve B of degree k, so that B is a genus zero curve, but we want a pointed curve, and we want this pointed curve to be stable. So it's a P1, PB, a pointed, stable curve of genus zero. So this is an object of on the moduli space that Alex was telling us about. So this lies in M0B bar. And what we want from our map well, first of all, we want the, I mean, this is a stable curve, this is a not necessarily stable, but at least nodal curve, this is a nodal curve. We want the nodes to go to nodes. So we want that we have singular points over singular points. We want to have some control on the ramification of this map pi. So we want pi to be unramified. Sorry, unramified away from, well, our singularities and those marked points. And we want to control a little bit this, the ramification on those points. So we want the ramification on those points to be simple. So we want pi to be simply branched. On these points, and we want some condition. What we want is that whenever we have a node of C, so we have this node here of C going to, say, some node of B, we want the ramification here to more or less agree, to agree with the ramification here. I'm not going to write this. But we want a condition also controlling the ramification on the singularities, on the nodes. So what we want? We want to understand stable k-gonal curves. And what this is saying is that for us to understand stable k-gonal curves, we need to be able to more or less construct these k-sheeted admissible covers. And what I want to do, I want to present today, is three such constructions. So I want to present three different constructions of k-sheeted admissible covers and see what we can get from that. So we want to use those admissible covers to study the gonality of some stable curve with respect to the gonality of the components of the curve, and also some partial normalizations. And what we're going to do, we're going to start with, for instance, consider the partial normalization. So let's say we have a node. What's the partial normalization? It's going to, break this node. So what we're going to do is the opposite thing. We start with this curve and assume we have some admissible curve, and try to construct one for this curve where I glue these two nodes. So this will be the first two of our three constructions. So this second part . So first we are with exactly that situation. So I assume I have a k-sheeted admissible cover. And I take two points, two smooth points of this curve. Not even try. Let me draw it like this. This curve C here, it doesn't need to be. I'm drawing it smooth, but it doesn't need to be smooth. It doesn't even need to be stable. It can be something like this, right? So, just a nodal thing. And I have these two nodes here. And what I want to do is to glue these two nodes. So this is my curve C. This will be what? C tilde. So this C tilde gluing N1 and N2. So I have an admissible cover for this guy. So I know this guy is k-gonal. I want to say something about C tilde. So I want to construct, like I said, I want to construct from this admissible cover for C an admissible cover for C tilde. And of course, we have two different cases to treat here, right? Because those two points of C can either be gone, they can either be taken to the same point in B or not. So we have to consider these two cases. So in my first case, let's assume that they do get taken to the same point. So I'm in this situation here. Mm. let's say this is my C, this is my B. Again, like I said, I'm drawing everything smooth because, well, it's easier, but none of those things need to be smooth. And like I said, I take two points here and one and two, and they get taken to the same point P. So this is my mark pi. Well, what do I want? I would like to have an admissible cover for this guy. But like we said, we don't need to, right? Because all we need to do is get an admissible cover for something that is stably equivalent to C tilde. So something that is stably equivalent to C tilde is something like this. Right? So you put a P1, this will be stably equivalent to the thing that you want. So let's do this. I put a P1 here. Now the thing that I got is stably equivalent to C. But it's not, of course, again, I mean, it's not a K-sheeted admissible cover anymore because, well, the first condition fails, right? You have to have singular points taken to singular points. So these two points now are singular points, so this needs to be two. So I put this. It's still failing because over this guy, you have this point, which is not a singular curve. So let's put a P1 here too. And you're done. You have to be a little bit careful with this branched condition here. I mean, you have to pay a little bit of attention. But yeah, basically, this is our condition. The curve C tilde that you get doing this is stably equivalent to the curve C. So you get a curve C prime, let's say, which is stably equivalent to the curve C tilde that you get. You get a map from this C prime to stable pointed curve of genus zero, and this map is the same thing, has the same degree as before. And it's very easy to see this because, for instance, how do you count degree in a very naive way? You take a point from the base and then you see how many primates you have. Like if you take a general point, then this should work. So if you take a point here and you count, oh, three, which is what I had before. And you can say, oh, but it will fail. I have take a point from here. Yeah, you do. And then you have one, two, and three because of the way of this map being. So yeah, you have the same degree as before. So this is the simplest of our constructions. And in the other case where the two points, N1 and N2, do not get taken to the same point in B, it's not so much more, I mean, it's a bit more complicated, but not so much. Yeah. Yes. Yes, you do. I mean, there is you got two new points. Like I said, I mean, of course, it's not. I mean, the drawing is very pretty and very simple to understand, but you have to take some care with smallest things. So, of course, our second case is when those two points do not get taken to the same point in B. So now we have this picture. Let's say this is my curve C. This is my genus zero curve B. And N1, N2. And P1 and P2 here. Again, I mean, you want to get something like this, but oh, it's enough to get something like this. So yeah, again, what I would like is to put a P1 here. But maybe it does work, but we tried and we couldn't make this exact construction work. So what we do is, I mean, there's nothing that says that you only can only put one, you can only contract one thing, you can contract a bunch of things. So instead of putting one P1 here, you can put a chain, right, if you want, and it will be the same. So this is what we do. Instead of put one, we put a chain of P1s here. And this one goes to B. This one goes to another one here, because remember, node goes to node. So this one goes to another. This one goes to another one here, but for the same reason, node goes to node. And well, the way I drawn don't have another, I mean, if let's say, Let's say because I draw very stupidly a map of degree one, so it's a stupid drawing. Let's say I have another point here and also another point here. And what do you need to do? Well, the same, right? Because node goes to node, so you need to put something that goes to this one here and something to go to this one here. Again, this is an admissible cover. I mean, like Carol said, you have to take some care with the ramification and to see that, because you're adding P1s here, right? And you need this thing in the bottom to still be a stable pointed curve of genus zero. So you need to make some calculations to see that you do have extra points at the land here. It's maybe what you were saying before. But yeah, you do. And what's the degree here? Again, let's count multiplicities. So over, let's say over this original B here, I have, well, the points that I already had, and one more. And also, if you count over the new yellow P1s that I put, again, you're going to see that what we get, that what we get is some, and sorry, this is, of course, not the original B, it's some B prime. You get a map pi prime from C prime to B prime. This C prime is, stably equivalent to the thing that we want. And like I said, I mean, you had the points that you had before from pi, and then you have one more. So this degree gets increased by one. So it's easy to see, for instance, if you have an irreducible nodal curve. And so let's say C is an irreducible nodal curve, C tilde, I don't know, and then you take the normalization. If this is, say, k-gonal, then you have a map. If this is k-gonal and you fix a map, this is smooth, so this B is actually just P1. So if I take the normalization of an irreducible nodal curve, and let's say this normalization is k-gonal for some k, then you can construct, following these instructions, a map from this C tilde to some B. So say B tilde. And I mean, not necessarily C tilde, but something stable equivalent to it. But you can get some information on the gonality of this guy. All you have to do is, whenever you have a pre-image of a node, so you have 2 points here, you have to see if this map pi takes those 2 nodes to the same point or not. If not, you just add one. So what we get is this result that says that if C tilde is a reducible nodal curve and the normalization is k-gonal, then the C tilde is k plus epsilon gonal for some epsilon between 0 and the number of nodes. This is not necessarily precise because it depends on not just the gonality of C tilde, but of the normalization, but on fixing a map, right? You have to fix this map pi in order to start this game. But well, I said I had 3 constructions, so my last one because here we are always gluing. I mean, it is really the idea of normalization, right? We are gluing just 2 points. We are taking. It could be. I mean, this could be disconnected in some sense. I could have this point, and I want to glue these two. But still, I mean, we are more or less dealing, at least in our minds, with something irreducible. So what happens if you want to compare it to the irreducible components of a reducible curve? So that's the third construction. So we have say C1 up to CN, not necessarily smooth, but connected for things to more or less make sense. And let's assume each of these curves has some gonality, and I'm going to fix some admissible cover. Of degree ki. And what I want is I want to glue those curves. So I have a curve here, I have a curve here, a curve here, and I want to glue them in some way. And when I say in some way, it's really in some way. I mean, it's more or less vague. So what I want to take is some points, smooth points. And I mean, remember here, we already dealt with the case where these pi's don't coincide. And there, the case is a bit more complicated. So I'm going to assume that they all have the same image. By my map, pi i. So this is our situation. And like I said, I want to glue all those connected curves in gluing those points that we picked. So C is a curve obtained, gluing. The points of one curve. Two points of other curves, which is incredibly vague, but I can't really make this more precise, because that's what we want. We have a curve here, and I pick a bunch of points. They all go to the same image in B, and I have another curve here. The same thing happens, and I have another curve, and the same thing happens. We don't need to have the same number of points in all the curves and just glue them all in some way. So I don't know, glue this to this, and this to this, and this to this again, in any way that you want. So the key thing is this condition here. So what we are going to construct is a admissible curve for this curve, or actually for a stable, for a curve that is stable equivalent to this. That shows, sorry. Yes. You're taking some delta I points in.
But I mean, you can put three different points in one point.
Well, no, because then you won't have something. You want something to be stable equivalent to a stable curve. So, no, just one to one. But, I mean, what you cannot do, you cannot glue 2 points of the same curve together. So you can't glue this N1 with this N delta. So they have to be in different curves, and of course one to one, because you want to know though. So this C is N. So this C is K1 plus et cetera plus Kn minus delta gonal, where this delta this delta is basically the number of nodes that you're gluing, the number of nodes that you're producing in your curve C. So I'm gonna draw an example, because those drawings are more general. Here, because we have any number of curves and any number of points and all that, I'm going to draw an example. I'm going to take 3 curves only. So my example, I'm going to take 3 curves. So let's say C1 with a map pi1. Maybe I don't draw the map because it gets confusing. So my map has degree 3. And I'm going to take 2 points here. So let's say this point, which point? This point and this point, right? And my second curve say C2 to B2. So here I have degree 2. And again, I'm going to take 2 points, those two. And the last curve, I'm going to take one off, also degree 3. And again, I'm going to choose just 2 points. Sorry, B3. Which points? Let's say I want to, these 2 points here. And let's say, let's pretend that I want to do a circular curve for some reason. So I want to glue this point to this one, and then this point to this one, and then again, this point to this one. Because like I said, I want circular curve for a reason, whatever. So my curve C will be a circular curve, gluing this node to this, then this to this, then this to this. Again, I drew, those C1, C2, C3 smooth, and also the B is smooth, but they don't need to be, right? All I need to do is take smooth points on those curves. As before, node has to go to node. Now these points are nodes, so this has to be a node. These points are nodes, so this has to be. These points are nodes, so this has to be. And of course, the easiest way, I want to connect everything, right? Because now I have a connected curve above and something disconnected on the bottom, on the image. So we can't have that. So I put a P1 here. And now you have to fix things, as before, because of course, node has to go to node. And this is not a node, it needs to be. Also here. But I still have a problem, because you see, those pink lines go to the pink line in the bottom, but this line above has only 2 nodes, this and this. As you see, the bottom has 3 nodes, right? So there has to be a node here, which maps to this one. So I'm going to put a B2 here. Also this, because the pink goes to the pink, and the pink has 3 nodes, this one has only 1. Let me increase my pink line here. And here I have something that goes, and I'm going to have to attach B2 and B3. Also here, node, node, and there has to be something else. Go mapping to B3. And what else? Here has to be something else mapping to B1. Is it enough? No, because here I also have pink line mapping to pink line. There is 1 node. Here there's 3, so I have to put those other 2. So I have to attach B1 and B2. Now we're good, right? At least in the terms of the singularities, now node goes to node, and there is only nodes above a node. How are those maps? Just a little word about how are those maps. Of course, for instance, this map here, it goes, we have to, like I said, we have to take care of the singularities here for the admissible curve condition. You have to be a bit careful, more or less. This, you want this singularity here to be of the same type of this in some sense. But here, you're just simply mapping B2 to B2. It's really a one-to-one map. And again, like all those Bs that I drew here that I put on the above, they map one-to-one to the bottom. So what is the degree of this pretty little thing that we drew? Let's count over B1, for instance. Again, in a very naive way, we want to count the degree of a map. You just take a point, a general enough point, and then you count the pre-image. So over B1, so over B1, what you have? You have the points on C1, which are 3. And then you have 1 point in this guy, and then one point in this guy. And this, I mean, of course, the calculation has to be a bit more careful, but this is exactly what we had. This 5 is exactly the k1 plus k2 plus k3 minus delta, because this is 3 plus 2 plus 2, and our delta is what? It's 2 plus 2 plus 2, sorry, divided by 2. There's something wrong with there? 5, 6, 7, minus 3. K3 is 3, sorry. So what did you get? We get exactly what you said. We get a map from our monster of a curve, but this monster of a curve, like I said, is exactly, I mean, it's exactly something that is stable equivalent to this curve obtained by gluing those points. You know, like I said, glue this to this and this to this and that guy to this one in order to form a circular curve. Again, like I said, I just chose an example to be circular. You don't need to have that in the theorem, in the construction. So, I mean, a consequence of this is that if C is stable, with, say, delta external nodes, what's an external node? It's something that is between two components and not something like this. This is not, this would be, say, an internal node because it's a node inside a component. So it's a node that's between, in the intersection of two components. And irreducible components, say, C1 up to CN, such that CI is KI. Gonal, so the situation we were before, then our curve C is k-gonal. For some number between the addition of all these k's minus delta to Kn minus plus delta minus, sorry. And it's a bit obvious what you have to do here, right? You use this construction, but this construction you can only use when the points that you are taking are being taken to the same image downstairs. And when it's not, you need the other construction that increases the degree by one. So this is why you don't have, I mean, this is what gets this bound here. So we have these three constructions, and I think they are nice, and they give us maps of Hurwitz schemes. So the last part of the talk, what I would like to present, is this: I study a little bit of the maps of Hurwitz schemes that these constructions give us. So again, let me start with the definition. So let me start with the H kg, which parametrizes maps of degree k from curves of genus G, and this is, it's not a compact, so it's compactified by this H bar, which is exactly the parameterizes exactly the thing that we are considering, right? So K cheated admissible covers, where C has genus G. And the dimension of this guy is exactly B minus 3. B, remember, is the number of market points we had on the P1, on the basis. And, well, by Himmel-Hurwitz, this is 2G plus 2K minus 2 minus 3, so minus 5. And also this guy here, this H bar, is irreducible. Well, we can't really work with this HKG, these guys here, because we want fixed points, right? Like we said, like in our construction, we need to fix not just the K-sheeted curve, but some points. So we need those fixed points. So we need to work really with modulized spaces of admissible curves with some fixed points. So what we need is something not more complicated, but a little bigger. So this guy here. So here I have, again, my K-sheeted admissible covers, say pi, where I want some fixed points on C. So C, how many points? The sum of those L's here. So say P1, 1, P, L11, et cetera, P1, N, P, LN, N. So this is a pointed sub-stable curve. And well, why did I take all those points? Well, because there are instances where you want to take those points to have the same image, and sometimes you want them to not have the same image. So I want to be able to take points which have the same image and points which don't. So let's say, PLEE, and so what we're saying is that those blocks of points all have the same image, and of course the points in this block do not have the same image of the points in this block. So this is just what we're stating here. And then of course, just by, it's easy to see that this guy will be again irreducible, it's easy to prove, and the dimension just adds the number of independent points that you take, how many independent points that you take, n, right? Because those points that have the same image, they don't add, they don't add degrees of freedom here. So this guy is reducible of dimension what you had before, 2k plus 2g minus 5 plus n. And like I said, the constructions that we showed, they give rise to maps of Hurwitz schemes. And I want to look at just three of those. The maps coming from the first two constructions. And because the last construction you have any number of curves and with any number of points, and I just want to take two curves with some market points, the same number of market points in both of them. So, like I said, we have three maps coming from those three constructions, but in the last construction, I want to fix things a little bit to make it simpler. So my first construction, I took admissible curve, and I marked two points that go to the same image. So this is this two here. And after I glue, I get something that is of the same degree, but the genus one more. So this is the construction. And what I show is that this is generically injective. And we look at the image. And we say, oh, let me write this. The general curve in the image of this guy is k-gonal, of course, and not r-gonal for r smaller than k. So this is a more or less stupid way to say that the actual gonality, remember in the beginning I said, oh, classically, the gonality is the smallest such k where you have a map from a smooth curve to a P1, a degree K map. So what we are saying here is that if you consider the general curve in the image of this map, then the actual gonality is K. You cannot have something smaller than that. And the same goes for the other maps. So our second construction was, again, we had K-cheated admissible cover, but here we fix the 2 points with different images. So I'm going to write this like 1 and 1. So I have one block of 1 point and another block of 1 point. They go to these different images. So in the light of this, with this definition, this is what I'm saying. And then we glued them with something like this. So we increase not just the degree, but also the genus by 1. And again, the same thing holds. This guy is generically injective. And the general curve in the image is exactly, has gonality, let's say, k plus 1. So is k plus 1 gonal, but it's not gonal for something smaller. And also, sorry, just to state the case of the last thing. In our last case, like I said, I'm only going to consider 2 curves. So let's say something like this, K1, G1 with delta marked points, and K2, G2, again with delta marked points. So I'm taking something like this, and I'm gluing delta points. So what we get is something that is K1 plus K2 minus delta gonal with genus G1 plus G2 plus delta minus 1. And the same thing holds. This map is generically injective, and the actual gonality of something in the image is this. You cannot have, if you take a general point in the image of this map, then you cannot construct something with a smaller degree, a divisible cover with a smaller degree. Or because I'm running out of time, I think I'm just going to stop.